This is a perfect world. It's inhabited by a single species. Each organism here has a balanced ratio of different cell types. The soil has a constant amount of energy and organic matter. But if we wait for a long enough time, a random mutation can disrupt this balance. The bigger the world, the more likely such a mutation will occur. Hello everyone. I continue researching worlds generated in my simulation, their ecosystems and stability. Knowing insides and principles of the simulation, I can easily predict the phenotype of generated organisms. For example, there will be a big variety of tiny colonial organisms. These organisms quickly stop growing and then start to accumulate energy for reproduction. Their opposite is superorganisms that grow non-stop in all directions. There are also linear organisms with simple algorithm of growing in straight lines. If linear organism has red or blue cells, it becomes a nomad moving across the field. And if an organism has green cells, it can create long lines that cross the entire field horizontally and vertically. Actually, it may also grow at different angles, but that way requires more cells. Then, evolution adapted organisms to the rectangular shape of the world, leaving only straight-growing, linear organisms. Predicting the types of organisms is easy, but predicting the principles of ecosystems is not. Certainly, there are the most common types, but sometimes the simulation creates something completely new. Can there be an optimal ecosystem, to which each simulation will eventually converge? What do you think? Please reply in the comments. Personally, I think that the size of the world is much important for this. Organisms on smaller worlds tend to create systems that are perhaps stable, but not optimal. Or they can simply perish from a minor inconvenience, which also happens. Here, a local ecosystem developed, but then, for some reason, it died. But if the world is larger, then there is a possibility that somewhere nearby there is another life that will happily fill the vacated area. And the bigger the world, the greater the chance that life will survive. However, there are nuances. In smaller worlds, the process of evolution is largely defined by random genetic drift and not by natural selection. Such worlds may contain unusual shapes and ecosystems. But with the increase in world size, the role of natural selection also increases. All stable but poorly adapted ecosystems trapped in local maxima will simply be replaced by more adapted ecosystems. The greater the world size, the more predictable its development and the less likely any unusual shapes and ecosystems. But, what if there was an infinite world? Unfortunately, my simulation cannot have such a world. Therefore, I decided to take another approach. I divided the simulation into two areas. Since my simulation is closed in a circle vertically and horizontally, the areas are separated by two boundaries. Once these two zones have reached a stable state, I will remove the boundaries and we will see which organisms will eliminate others. Because the organisms in each zone have less space now, the number of extinctions has increased. So I have to start the simulation again and again. I am also unable to control the type of ecosystems in the zones, so I have to work with what we have. For now, worlds dominated by linear organisms are the most successful. Linear organisms with green cells produce energy from sunlight, while nomad organisms consume excess energy. But these nomads should not just passively collect energy, they should also actively destroy obstacles in their way. So they are more like active predators. Moreover, If the linear organisms with green cells did the same, the chance of this ecosystem eliminating others would increase even further. Organisms in this world attack anything, including each other. It would seem that this would dramatically reduce the competitiveness of these organisms. However, it appears that linear organisms are best suited to surviving in such environments. You can see how they actively pass through each other, yet somehow manage to coexist in dense communities. They make it more difficult for each other to thrive, but on the other hand, a newcomer would not be able to withstand this hardship. If one of these zones develops such an ecosystem, it would quickly destroy the other. There are also other fairly competitive ecosystems, such as a world with unicellular predators, which are able to consume almost all types of cells. However, their only weakness is their inability to consume transportation cells, which prevents them from infiltrating superorganisms. But such occurrences are quite rare, so, for now, I have not had a chance to witness their competition with other successful worlds. Now, we will witness a clash between two ecosystems. The world is divided into two areas. In the right area, we have a fairly ordinary world with colonies, nomads, and superorganisms. In the left zone, we find a world filled with green-celled, linear organisms, without any nomads. The linear organisms look rather nice. Note that they only have green cells on one side. They try to consume any excess on their own, but clearly, their efforts are not sufficient. The concentration of resources in the soil is growing, so, as a response, the first nomads have emerged. They are also active predators. Meanwhile, in the right zone, nomads simply passively collect the resources produced by the colonies and superorganisms. To make it easier to differentiate between the two ecosystems, I'll color them according to their origin. In the left zone, all of the organisms are the descendants of a single origin cell. Meanwhile, in the right zone, organisms derive from two ancestors, one for nomads and the other for everyone else. Let's remove the boundary. The nomadic predators from the left side just roam the fields and maim anyone in their path. The organisms from the left side just die as a result. Only the colonial organisms survive the longest. While one ecosystem replaces another, let's talk about predictable development again. I talked about a perfect, boundless world where conditions are the same everywhere. Fortunately, the real world isn't like that. Just the division into land and water makes the development of a uniform, planet-wide ecosystem impossible. Furthermore, land and water aren't monoliths, but consist of various parts, such as depth and salinity for water and temperature and humidity for land. In some places, day and night can last for 6 months, and somewhere, winter doesn't differ from summer. So our world will inevitably have a wide variety of ecosystems. But things aren't that simple. Many ecosystems are quite similar, and organisms from one can get into another. In the modern world, even distance doesn't matter that much. The invasion of foreign species into an ecosystem is one of today's largest environmental problems, posing a significant threat to biodiversity. And humanity plays a significant role in these situations. For example, we can look at rabbits in Australia and hogweed in Eastern and Northern Europe as examples of invasive species that can significantly alter the existing ecosystem and even cause the extinction of certain species. Let's take a look at our simulation again. We can now see the last remaining organisms in the right zone. Soon, they will become completely extinct. It seems like the world has come to a standstill, but if we look more closely, we can see that evolution hasn't stopped. Linear organisms have developed green cells on both sides and are able to form very dense structures. Like superorganisms, they are now able to collect large amounts of energy and leave behind huge traces of excess energy upon death. I model all this on a computer, but there are interesting field experiments. The most prominent example is Project Biosphere 2. It was an attempt to create a closed ecosystem that could provide food and air for up to 8 people. Such a system could be used to build autonomous colonies in space. But something went wrong. Microorganisms and insects began multiplying in unexpectedly large numbers, and the oxygen level dropped to 15%. Oxygen had to be pumped in from the outside in order to keep people participating in the project. The experiment demonstrated how unreliable humans can be when predicting the development of ecosystems, and how difficult it is to create a tiny ecosystem that can sustain life for people. The stability of an ecosystem is a fragile thing. Sure, life itself will go on, but there might not be a place for humanity within such an ecosystem. By the way, after the collision of two ecosystems, sometimes mixing occurs, and as a result, one species from each original ecosystem remains in the final one. This is a kind of compromise, if you will. In the next video, we'll talk about the ins and outs of this simulation. Don't forget to like and subscribe. I would be very happy if you left a comment. Also, I want to thank everyone who supports me on Patreon. Your support helps me create new content. Until next time.